2024 will be a record year for elections around the world. Over 4 billion people, more than half of Earth's population, are expected to cast a ballot. 7 out of 10 of the most populous nations are going to the polls, and many elections will be in countries consequential to the news cycle. Taiwan held its presidential elections on January 13th, which saw William Lai of the Democratic Progressive Party win with over 40% of the vote. Lai's election is expected to make relations between Taiwan and mainland China more antagonistic. Both Ukraine and Russia, who remain locked in war with one another, have scheduled elections in March. And U.S. elections in November are bound to draw intense international attention in what is shaping up to be a rematch of the 2020 elections.
Democracy is still at risk. This is not hyperbole.
Many academics, political analysts, and think tanks expect 2024 to be a major stress test on the concept of democracy itself. And one particular variable that will further complicate this test is the rise of AI tools and the ability to create convincing deepfake news content.
We're entering an era in which our enemies can make it look like anyone is saying anything at any point in time, even if they would never say those things. Moving forward, we need to be more vigilant with what we trust from the internet. That's a time when we need to rely on trusted news sources.
Deepfakes and cheapfakes are not new, but with the explosion of AI that was ushered in by the introduction of ChatGPT just over a year ago, we saw deepfakes proliferate. And the types of deepfakes that we've been looking at, which are these fake news segments using the real likeness and real logos of real news outlets and the faces of real broadcasters, are seemingly new. And they are particularly problematic right now as we are heading into a really high stakes election and also as we are in the midst of a war. We have seen deepfake news segments from top prominent anchors at all sorts of outlets, ranging from CNN to CBS and beyond.
Truth or fake, you're beginning with a story of a video on social media where President Zelensky appears to surrender to Russian forces. What's that about?
A false video of President Zelensky was diffused yesterday where he's apparently making an announcement giving up to Russian forces. This video was diffused on a hacked Ukrainian news website called Ukraine 24.
I've been seeing it sort of come in and out for several years now, but in really seeing it consistently in high quality, I would say in the last 12 months.
Стало тільки гірше. Значно гірше. Більше нема ніякого завтра.
There's two main reasons for it. One is that the technology to create deepfakes of news anchors has just gotten better. But two, and I think this is also important, is that most of the major social media companies have eviscerated their trust and safety teams. And that's not just Twitter, by the way. That one's easy, but it's even the Facebooks of the world, the YouTubes and the TikToks. And so as a result of that, when people create fake content, it's much, much easier to distribute. So remember that when we're talking about deep fakes, there's really three parts to it. There's the underlying technology, the bad actors who are misusing these technologies, but then there's the spread of that. And the spread of that technology is not an AI question, that's a social media question. All three things have now lined up. The technology is getting better, bad actors are figuring out that you can monetize or abuse this content, and the social media companies have fallen asleep at the wheel again.
Using video from the CBS News archives, Chris Umi was able to train his computer to learn every aspect of my face and wipe away the decades. This is how I looked 30 years ago. He can even remove my mustache.
There are two approaches to detecting manipulated media, what we call proactive and reactive. So the reactive is sort of my bread and butter here as an academic at UC Berkeley. What we do is we take an image, an audio or a video, we run it through a battery of tests, and we try to figure out if it's been manipulated or AI generated, all after the fact. Right, so stuff gets online, a fact checker contacts us, we analyze the content, and we eventually tell the fact checker, and they eventually set the record straight. And meanwhile, the whole world has moved on and gotten defrauded to the tune of millions of dollars. So the reactive stuff is good, if you will, as a postmortem. But at the speed at which social media moves, half-life of a social media post can be measured in minutes, you're not there fast enough to deal with the damage. The proactive techniques, the way they work, is that if you pick up your phone and record something, or you are in the business of generating AI content, you can inject into that content, whether it's real or AI generated, a digital watermark that is cryptographically signed. And then downstream, your browser or a piece of software can read that watermark and say, nope, I know that this is AI generated, or in fact that it is real, and you can do that instantaneously. This only works when you have good players. So when Adobe decides it's gonna put watermarks into its content, well great, I trust Adobe, but a lot of bad players out there, and a lot of this code for creating deepfakes is open source. So if you have open source and you've got some code in there for inserting a watermark, well, the bad guy's gonna go in there and remove that code and we're off to the races. So the watermarking absolutely are going to play a role here, but they will not in and of themselves solve the problem, because there's always ways around this technology, and there's open source and there's bad actors. But I'm super supportive of that for the big players like Adobe, OpenAI, and Midjourney, and maybe we lop off half the problem.
I'm being replicated by a stand-in actor to read this monologue, and then my appearance and voice is changed using artificial intelligence. So now that I've got your attention, let's send it back to the real Brian Sullivan as we dive deeper into this revolutionary technology.
Some of the more prominent clips that we had found were actually from a TikTok and YouTube creator. His name is Krishna Sahai. Some of his most watched and most viral videos were news segments with CBS anchors that interviewed him as the only survivor in a school shooting.
We are now interviewing the only survivor of the recent Texas school shooting, high school student Krishna Sahai.
In one example, he was the shooter. In one example, he was a survivor. And across all the examples, he was mocking the school shooting itself.
We are now interviewing the only survivor in the recent school shooting, TikToker Krishna Sahai.
Dude, that must have been absolutely traumatizing. What was going through everyone's head, man?
Bullets, duh.
One of the most interesting pieces of this and troubling pieces of this is that in many cases, the deepfake news segments that we found were getting more views and more virality than actual news segments from those same outlets that were posted to their blue check verified social media accounts around the same time. One example that we found was from Face the Nation. This YouTube and TikTok creator had a segment that was actually one of his more innocuous segments that was about a group of kids jumping in an elevator, and the elevator crashes down, and then they owe this building more than $500,000 in damages.
Over $560,000 in damages liable after TikToker Krishna Sahai destroys elevator.
The worst thing. So it's not the most threatening example, but what was so fascinating about it was that it was viewed more than 300,000 times, and it used, again, the Face the Nation logo, and on the Face the Nation's social media account on TikTok, the post from the same day only garnered 7,000 views. So when fake news segments from a creator that uses the outlet's logo or anchors from that station is in fact getting more eyeballs than actual news clips from the actual outlets' blue check social media accounts, you can see how that could become extremely problematic and deter people from actually following what is considered real news.
So even deepfake technology is protected by the First Amendment. Lying is protected by the First Amendment. I could make false statements and I am not going to be punished unless that false statement carries some additional harm with it, direct harm, usually harm that is perpetrated against an individual. And frankly, when you're in, you know, you're in a situation talking, making political statements, that's the strongest protection the First Amendment gives. So a general statement of a political nature, which I think a lot of deepfakes we're seeing in this coming year will be, are actually protected even when they're lies, unless there is some direct harm that is inflicted upon an individual or even, you know, to some degree, a small segment of society. And what we're talking about here are things like defamation. Oh, you know, if I say something or if I use a deepfake in a way that makes a false statement about you, harms your reputation, that would be something that is now outside of the First Amendment, not protected by the First Amendment. While we do have a collective media literacy problem in this country where people don't know the difference necessarily between news and opinion, or even within news, the difference between a good source and a not so good source, or an outright lying source that has an agenda of its own, We're getting better with that. I think people collectively, and this is anecdotal, people collectively are getting better at identifying, you know, separating truth from falsity. It's harder when you bring in video because they don't know the same tells that we're already being trained to look for in printed or online information. So there's a level of validity, a veracity to something that they see in video and they go, oh, it's video. It's really hard to fake that. And it's happening so much. And frankly, it's mostly being perpetrated by people who want to take advantage of you. You know, we know that in the 2020 and 2016 elections, a lot of the misinformation during the election period was coming from overseas, from places we aren't going to be able to get to, you know, to punish. And I think that's probably what's going to happen again, which is what makes it so difficult to combat.
You said this is the most comprehensive report that we've gotten about the 2020 election and foreign interference by the intelligence community. And it does make clear that this massive Russian influence campaign was designed, orchestrated by Putin to denigrate Joe Biden and to support the reelection of President Donald Trump. I want to read.
Now, I've heard people say, look, disinformation, deepfakes, they can't change an election. And I don't think that's true, because if you look at the last two election cycles, the difference between one candidate or another in terms of the electoral vote came down to some 80,000 votes in a handful of states. You don't have to move tens of millions of votes. You have to move tens of thousands of votes. And not only that, I know where those votes are. If I'm the bad guy trying to interfere with your election, I know exactly what states, I know exactly what towns, what localities, and I know how to find these people on social media and manipulate them. And that, I think, should worry us. And you need a series of defenses. And so you need a series of proactive defenses and a series of reactive defenses, and you need better corporate responsibility, and you need some liability, and you need some regulation, and you need good consumer protection. And so, you know, when you put all those pieces together, I think we can start to trust things that we see online a little bit more.
It's possible, it's difficult, both in a legal sense and a practical sense, to bring a defamation lawsuit against someone based on their creation of a deep fake. So let's just say you create a deep fake about me. I have to show very specifically that not only you lied, you harmed me in some way, and specifically you harmed my reputation. Ah, but beyond that, I have to show a number of other things. I have to show us specifically that you made a materially and substantially false assertion of fact about me that was published and harmed my reputation, and that you did it with some level of fault.
This ability to create so many images so rapidly, it's an incredibly powerful tool.
New artificial intelligence technology makes it easy to create fake images that can look very realistic, like these created by artist and online trust and safety expert Tim Boucher.
I think absolutely we are going to see the campaigns use it against their opponents. We also can see campaigns using it to bolster their own opponent, to create images of them looking more heroic or taller, for example. But here's the other place that we can, that the candidates can use it. Imagine now there's a hot mic of a candidate or a sitting president saying something inappropriate or illegal. They don't have to cop to it anymore. They can say it's fake. And so they can also deny reality. So the deep fake technology is a double-edged sword. You can create harmful content, but you can also dismiss real content by simply saying it's fake and muddying the waters.
I think the most important thing right now is to remind people to think before they share, to be a bit skeptical of what they are consuming, and to really try to pay attention to the source. If the source is an authoritative news outlet, great. I don't think we can rely anymore on which accounts are blue check verified accounts and which aren't, because now we know that many of the social media platforms allow people, any person, to purchase verification, or the bar is significantly lower for verified accounts. But I think that you should really be focused on where the news is coming from, who is posting it, what their motive may be, and what sorts of perspectives they are including in the clip. I think all of those things are able to help us, especially in a very fast-moving news environment, better calculate what is worth sharing versus what isn't, and help us better understand what we are consuming.
We do not want the government to step into these discussions about truth and falsity. We don't want the government to step into decisions about this is my opinion, this is your opinion, this is the right opinion. We want the government to stay out of it. We have a concept in the United States called the marketplace of ideas. And what it says is we have a place where we can all come together and buy and sell not products or goods, but thought, ideas, values. And in that marketplace of ideas, we not only get to test our own thoughts and maybe change what we believe, we may be able to change other people's opinions, but we're also reinforced in what we believe. And the whole point, though, is we get to sort it out for ourselves. We know that phrase that exists, a lie travels halfway around the world before the truth can put its shoes on. I think now the lie travels around the world once, twice, three times before the truth even wakes up, right? We've dealt with technological changes before throughout our nation's history. The First Amendment remains unchanged. It's been there all along, and it's worked. And I believe in the First Amendment, and I believe it's going to work this year as well. Thanks. Just one last thing while we're rolling. How do I know you're not deepfaking me right now? That's one of my worries. I mean, we're sitting here about deepfakes. We could turn, I don't even know if I see this. How will I even know whether you're deepfaking me?